We're the Ring System, and welcome back to our channel after quite a long hiatus. This video is an introduction to a series discussing relevant scientific research to subjects of dissociation, DID, OSDD, or experiences of multiplicity, both to start a conversation in the community about recent and relevant scientific literature, and also to make some of this literature more accessible, because oftentimes they are behind a paywall or they're loaded with scientific jargon that can be difficult to parse. And first and foremost, I want to acknowledge that even though we're going to be discussing scientific literature, this is still going to be influenced by us. Just due to the nature of creating content, we're going to end up picking literature that we think is interesting or intriguing or worthwhile of having a discussion about. And when we're describing the literature, it's going to be through our eyes, through our own perspective, and through our own biases. Because an important part of discussing scientific literature, whether you're a researcher or a reader, is having an opinion about it. Our opinion is going to come through when we make these videos, and even though we're planning to do our best to specifically delineate and notate when we are talking about our own opinion, it is going to sneak in there even when we're just describing the article. And finally, we can also be wrong when we're interpreting the literature. Some articles are really complex, really difficult to read, and there are going to be times where we are just going to get them wrong. If we do that, feel free to drop something down in the comments and we'd love to have a discussion or even make another video talking about different interpretations of a specific piece of scientific literature. So moving forward, what I want to do with this first video is give you guys a general overview of the field of scientific research, where we are now, where we have been, and the current controversies in the field that researchers are arguing about through their publications. And I think there's no better way to start that conversation than talking about the book Dissociation and the Dissociative Disorders, the DSM-5 and Beyond. To give a short summary of why I love this book so much and why I think it's such a great introduction to the field of dissociative research is because this book represents an unprecedented attempt to collect, define, clarify, and expand an entire field of knowledge about dissociation, synthesize what we already know, and identify areas for future research. This book features a collection of essays by top researchers across the field, writing about different areas and topics within the study of dissociation. And the book as a whole was collected and edited by Paul Dell and John O'Neil, two important and influential people in the field over the years. To give you a little bit of background about Dell, because we happen to know a little more about him, Dell served as a past president of the ISSTD, the International Society for the Study of Trauma and Dissociation, and he helped create the multidimensional inventory of dissociation, which was one of the many tools used to diagnose DID. He is still going in the field, he's still publishing, he's still attending conferences, and he has proposed new criteria for DID to be included in the next update of the DSM. The book he and John O'Neil edited and collected was published in 2009, so it is a little bit old, and since then there has been an updated revision that's been published. But in the updated edition, they acknowledge that many of the chapters of the first book still stand. But really, I want to discuss this book in this video in particular due to the preface. The preface of this book does exactly what I want this video to do. It introduces the reader to the state of the field, and it summarizes the controversies about defining dissociation that are still ongoing to this day. How we define different types of dissociation, how broad we want the general definition of dissociation to be, and whether or not specific experiences can fit together within the category of dissociation as a whole. It's a lot to cover, but the first thing the preface does is give an introduction to the book, which I still think is useful, so let's start there. And if you want to skip the book intro, timestamps are in the description. So, a little bit of history. In the year 2000, the ISSTD, the International Society for the Study of Trauma and Dissociation, appointed a task force of leading researchers to create a universal definition of dissociation that could be used widely within the field. And the issue is that they deliberated for years and they couldn't agree on a definition. Here is a direct quote. "We had known at the outset that the term dissociation was often used in a vague, overly broad fashion, but we had never anticipated that we might be unable to agree on a definition." This process continued with the researchers struggling to agree on a definition. They organized panels at conferences where speakers presented their contrasting opinions. These panels and discussion groups were well attended by researchers in the community, but they were still unsuccessful. If anything, these discussions just raised new points and new controversies that were yet unheard of. Another direct quote from the book reads, "In other words, the already broad meaning of dissociation became broader still, rather than narrower." And faced with a controversy that seemed like it would never resolve, John O'Neil and Paul Dell, who were heading some of these discussions, decided to move forward by creating this book, Dissociation and the dissociative disorders, the DSM-5 and beyond. It serves as a broad response to these discussions and these debates, encapsulating viewpoints across the field that sometimes contrast, sometimes clash and conflict, and sometimes go well with each other. But this book serves as a primer to introduce the reader to all sides of the debate that is going on about dissociation in the scientific world. Secondly, the intention of this book was to inform and prepare the field to write the DSM-5. The book influenced the Dissociative Disorders Literature Review, which became the blueprint for the working group that wrote the DSM-5. Functionally, this book helped lay the groundwork for where the field was headed and where it ended up today, both in terms of how the DSM-5 was written and the ISSTD's creation of international treatment guidelines in 2011, which have not been updated and are still used today. So let's talk about it. There are conditions, states, and disorders that are commonly labeled as dissociative. And there is a huge controversy about what classifies as dissociation, how we want to describe it, and whether or not different types of experience can even be classified in the same category. So we're going to go through the common controversies identified by Dell and O'Neil one by one. The first controversy is whether or not the word dissociative can be used to describe surface-level experiences or underlying mechanisms. And to get into that, a description of surface-level experiences would look like signs, symptoms, and the first-person experience of dissociation. Whereas describing a mechanism, such as the reason why we're dissociating. So a practical application of the surface side of this debate is saying that the experience of feeling out of touch with the world or reality or with oneself, like that feeling, that first personal experience is what dissociation is. Whereas the second group, the mechanism group, says that the psychological underpinnings of that experience, so what your brain actually does that makes you feel disconnected from reality or from yourself. And they argue that only that can be described as dissociation. This specific controversy, more than anything, is a semantic debate. Both the surface level and the mechanism exist, and whether or not we use the word dissociation to describe one or the other or both is really the question at hand here. The second controversy is nested within the first one. Specifically, it looks at different types of mechanisms, and the argument is concerned about whether or not dissociation applies to mechanisms that are active or passive. Is dissociation something our brain is unwittingly doing, or is it something we are passively suffering from? Two examples of active dissociation: defensive mechanisms that we do to avoid trauma, or behavioral inclinations. And examples of arguments that say dissociation is passive argue that dissociation is a division in consciousness, or that dissociation is a disintegration of functioning. If you think about it, we could technically have control over our defensive mechanisms to trauma or our behavioral inclinations, but we might not be able to control a literal breakdown in functioning or a literal division in consciousness. And this controversy has a lot of implications for how dissociation is treated. How you would go about resolving an unwitting active form of dissociation is different than how you'd go about resolving a passive mechanism of dissociation. Do we have to teach a person to stop actively feeding into cycles of behavior from traumatic stress? Or do we have to structurally change something within the environment or the person to see any improvement? So we've covered the semantic debate and the mechanism debate. And the third debate that is really prevalent in research is a discussion about whether dissociation, the word, should apply to all experiences that involve a disconnection with consciousness, including ones that are normative, non-pathological, or non-disordered, or should it only describe experiences that negatively impact your daily functioning, which are analyzed through a pathological framework. And even then, before we dig into how we categorize normative and pathological experiences of dissociation, there's the primary debate about how to draw a distinction between the two categories. Is the line between normal and pathological sharp, or is it blurred? Is it a spectrum, or is it entirely different categories? And a lot of arguments on this subject in particular comes back to the mechanism. The people who argue that they're in completely separate categories argue that there are separate mechanisms for normal and pathological forms of dissociation. But that is still in debate, it's still being discussed, and we haven't quite found an answer, how we differentiate experiences that are kind of in the middle. And then we have the biggest debate, which is how we are defining the word dissociation in particular. Does the word dissociation apply to all experiences of disconnection, or does it only apply to some? And this is where I'm going to pull out the diagram. What the preface of this book outlines is that researchers have identified four different categories of experience that may or may not be described as dissociation. They lie upon two different axes, this normal and pathological axes, which I've just described, where non-pathological experiences are normal, healthy, and non-disruptive, whereas pathological experiences impair daily functioning or cause clinical levels of distress and are approached through a medicalized framework. And then the second axis that I have is faculty dissociation and multiplicity. And here are some quotes straight from the book. Faculty dissociation implies a disruption in the normal integration of psychological faculties or functioning of a given consciousness within a sense of self. So examples of faculty dissociation would be things like amnesia, things like feeling disconnected from the world around you, losing a standard sense of time, lapses in attention, perception, memory, and consciousness, all within a single sense of self. Whereas multiplicity implies the presence of more than one center of consciousness, more than one self. And as such, you get this array of four squares. We have pathological faculty dissociation, things such as dissociative amnesia, and we have non-pathological faculty dissociation, things like highway hypnosis, where after driving to your destination, you can't quite remember the process of actually getting there. Then we have pathological forms of multiplicity, such as DID and OSDD, where the experience of multiplicity itself causes a negative impact on functioning in daily life. And then we have non-pathological forms of multiplicity, which are healthy forms of non-disordered multiplicity that may or may not be accepted within the broader culture. And I want to be clear that the existence of all four of these boxes is not what's up for debate. The scientific field agrees that all four of these experiences are real and exist and worth studying. The question at hand is, do we call all of these boxes dissociation? Does the word dissociation describe each of these boxes? Or is there a different term other than dissociation that properly describes the non-pathological experiences? Is there a different term that better describes multiplicity experiences, both pathological and non-pathological? Is there a specific term to describe each one of these boxes? There are countless people arguing about which boxes should be used to describe dissociation. For example, Constance Dalenberg is a strong advocate that non-pathological disconnections of psychological faculties should count as dissociation. And she is often up against Anno van der Hart, one of the authors of the theory of structural dissociation, who strongly argues that only pathological multiplicity should be called dissociation, and all of these boxes are something else entirely. And in contrast to him, we have Lawrence Kermer and Rebecca Seligman, who argue that both non-pathological disconnections of psychological faculties and non-pathological experiences of multiplicity should be considered dissociation, not just pathological multiplicity. And even though this book was published in 2009, this debate about the four squares and the different experiences and whether or not we should categorize them as dissociation is still ongoing to this day. There are papers published just this year, just last year, just a couple months ago that are still arguing about what we consider dissociation and what should count as dissociation. So where do we go from here? Well, the good news is that Paul Dell and John O'Neil managed to settle on a definition for pathological forms of dissociation. Thinking about the chart again, these top two boxes of pathological forms. So here's what they concluded. The essential manifestation of pathological dissociation is a partial or complete disruption of the normal integration of a person's psychological functioning. Dissociative disruptions unexpectedly change the person's usual functioning in ways that the person cannot easily explain. Any aspect of a person's conscious psychological functioning can be disrupted by dissociation. Specifically, dissociation can unexpectedly disrupt, alter, or intrude upon a person's consciousness and experience of body, world, self, mind, agency, intentionality, thinking, believing, knowing, recognizing, remembering, feeling, wanting, speaking, acting, seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, and so on. Although some dissociative disruptions involve amnesia, which is only detected later by the person, and sometimes not detected at all, the vast majority of dissociative experiences do not involve amnesia. Instead, the vast majority of dissociative intrusions into functioning are consciously experienced at the moment of their occurrence. And because these disruptions of normal functioning are utterly unanticipated, they are typically experienced by the person as startling, autonomous intrusions into their usual ways of responding or functioning. The most common dissociative intrusions include hearing voices, depersonalization, derealization, made thoughts, made urges, made desires, made emotions, and made actions. Although some dissociative disruptions of normal functioning are visible to an observer, i.e., conversion symptoms such as blindness or paralysis, most dissociative symptoms are entirely subjective, with minimal to no external signs, thus they are invisible to others. And that's where I'm going to leave the discussion of the book today. In closing, I want to talk a little bit more about why we are doing this and what we plan to do moving forward. First and foremost, as we've grown and learned over the past 3 or 4 years, we've realized that some statements in our previous videos have not been entirely accurate. Beyond remaking the videos that we think need to be remade, we want to repair some of that by facilitating conversations directly about research itself. We're also planning on doing some other things, talking about the history of the community, our own experiences, or community knowledge. I don't want to discount how invaluable that type of education is because it offers something that science doesn't, which is direct lived experience. That's where we came from, and that will always be a part of us, and I think not talking about that is missing out on something important. However, we hope that this series can help fulfill one of the original goals we had for the channel in the first place, creating a place where people can learn about dissociation and multiplicity from someone who has direct lived experience in a way that reflects and engages with the current scientific knowledge on the subject. Thank you so much for watching and for being here and being patient over the past couple years as we've collected ourselves and gone through our own personal journey in relation to YouTube and the community and our own plural experience. And I hope to see you in the next video and many more in the future.